A very good afternoon to all of you, and I would like to welcome you to this webinar on fetal growth restriction, early versus late. Before I begin, I would like to thank Dr. Alpesh Gandhi, president of FOCSI this year, for providing this opportunity to speak on this very special topic on growth restriction. During this COVID time, when everybody is really, handling so much of COVID patients and, a lot of confusion, but we still have to, manage our basic obstetric patients, and of which fetal growth restriction continues to affect our practice in our day-to-day lives. I'm Dr. K. Aparna Sharma. I'm additional professor in All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. I am an obstetrician and gynecologist, but essentially I practice fetal medicine, and we at Division of Maternal Fetal Medicine, AIIMS, we practice fetal medicine and we do a lot of fetal interventions, and management of growth restriction is like day in and day out practice. So this is a topic which is very close to my heart. So I think, I hope I will be able to do some justice. So defining fetal growth restriction to begin with. So I think fetal growth restriction should be defined as when fetus does not reach its biological growth potential because of genetic or environmental factors. This has to be differentiated from a small for gestational age birth, where the infant is born with an estimated fetal weight which is less than the 10th centile. Now, as we go on, we will be talking more about the difference between SGA and FGR, the early versus late. But more importantly, why do we have to talk about it? The important fact is that with the increasing improvement in antenatal care, we are increasingly able to actually detect, small babies. And even if we are able to detect, we need to understand that we are not able to treat it. Whatever the etiology, we are not able to treat the smaller babies. So it is crucial to make an accurate diagnosis at a correct gestational age, as it determines the timing of delivery and perinatal outcomes. So this is more important. Now, the most important aspect of understanding FGR developed after this very important study, otherwise there were a lot of definitions which were floating about for fetal growth restriction. Now, the most importantly, after this study, it was seen that a baby who was actually under the third centile with an abnormal umbilical artery Doppler was found to consistently be associated with adverse perinatal outcomes. So this was the definition from where the definition of IUGR came in. So this is the point where the IUGR, the definition of IUGR came in. Now, when we are trying to manage IUGR, we have to understand the steps in the management. So in the first step would be identifying a small fetus. The second step would be to understand if it's a small fetus, whether it is an FGR or whether it is a small for gestational age fetus. The third thing is to understand whether it's an early onset or a late onset FGR. And the fourth is a stage-based management protocol that we would be discussing. Now, the first would be identifying a small fetus. And for that, the most important part is accurate dating, which we should be doing from the first trimester ultrasound. And we all know that if we are able to do an ultrasound in the first trimester at less than 14 weeks, then it has got the most maximum sensitivity for an accurate dating as compared to, and if the CRL and the LMP, they correspond to less than 7 days, then we are most accurate in dating. And this is most important for a later on assessment of growth to understand that if they are wrong dates or if it is an actual growth restriction. So first of all, the most important part of identification of small fetus is an accurate dating. Now, the next important part is accurate measurement. So how would you know that this fetus is small? This would be by a first thing that is most commonly done is by a clinical examination, which is most commonly done by a fundal height determination. However, it will only detect 16% of the small for gestational age fetuses. And more importantly, because we are talking about also late FGR, late onset FGRs may not be detected by a fundal height estimation. Then again, we need to understand what is the role of third trimester ultrasound in monitoring. So this is the modality by which we are mainly detecting the ultrasound, and hence what is the role of actually a universal screening ultrasound for detection of the small for gestation fetuses. Is it that the ultrasound should be prompted only by doing a clinical examination following doing an ultrasound, or we should have a universal ultrasound? So it has been seen that universal screening tripled the detection rate of small for gestational age as compared to selective screening. Now, if we have detected a small baby, now we are doing ultrasound routinely and we see that, okay, we are detecting many more small babies. But if we are detecting many more small babies and they have normal outcomes, okay, I might be having a small baby, but eventually the outcome remains normal, then what is the point of my detecting it? So we need to understand that if there is actually any benefit of detecting small babies. So it has been seen in one of the big studies, and in 2013, it was actually seen that if we are detecting FGR, so FGRs are actually responsible for a lot of stillbirths which happen in the late trimester, you know, late onset, late stillbirths around 37 weeks. So there is an increased risk of stillbirth at SGS which are delivered at term. So sometimes, you know, we have those unexplained stillbirths in which we think everything was normal. Then why did that stillbirth happen? An undetected severe FGR had a fourfold increase in adverse fetal outcome. So we do have cases when we do not understand the reason why that adverse perinatal outcome happened when everything was normal antenatally. So late onset FGRs explains a lot of those incidents like that. So now we come to the second aspect, which is to understand the difference between a constitutionally small fetus versus a fetus which is growth restricted. Now, if a baby is small, so we have seen that, okay, the baby is clinically small, or on an ultrasound you thought that the baby is small, and you probably thought about an etiology which we will be kind of enumerating after a few slides. And you ruled out a primary defect and excluded an extrinsic cause and isolated fetal smallness. Then are there associated Doppler abnormalities or not? Now, if there are no associated Doppler abnormalities, it is a small for gestational age fetus, or it's a constitutionally small fetus. But if there are associated Doppler abnormalities, it suggests signs of adaptation. That means that the baby is struggling to adapt, and it is reflected in some form or the other by an abnormal Doppler finding. So these are some of the differences which will tell you whether it is a growth restricted fetus or SGA, because for SGA we don't believe in doing anything. For a growth restricted fetus we will have to do something. So SGA combined with a Doppler abnormality would be a fetal growth restriction. Now, before I continue, just let me give you a very, very common scenario. Okay. Now, this is a 28-year-old low risk primate, your friend maybe, or you know, you have a person in your neighbor who gets pregnant, and she has just come to you because you're a next door neighbor and a doctor, and comes to you, her blood, and the reporting is such that says that biparietal diameter is 29 to 30 weeks, and the abdominal circumference is, the femur length is 29 weeks and the abdominal circumference is 26 weeks, and she's sure of her dates. Now, you know, are you worried? You know, there is a discrepancy of 3 weeks in your abdominal circumference. Now, this is a very common scenario, and I'm sure if you're doing your ultrasound yourself, or you have your radiologist colleagues who will be giving such kind of a report, and it is very normal that, you know, you might get worried about it. So what would be your next logical step? What would you do? Now, what should we do is that, you know, we should try and chart the measurements on a growth chart, that at this particular gestation, this particular measurement, what is the centile of my BPD? What is the centile of my estimated fetal weight? So according to this, my BPD centile looks all right, although the AC centile might be a bit lower, but it is still more than the 10th centile, right? And the FL is fine. So overall, and the Dopplers look all right, right? So to conclude, this patient has normal Dopplers. The AC is on the 18th centile, but all are within range, and the AFI is normal, right? So at 30 weeks, although she had parameters of abdominal circumference, which traditionally and, you know, classically we've described as an asymmetrical IUGR, abdominal circumference is less. So maybe I should start getting worried, but we need to think about charting them on the centile chart. And if the estimated fetal weight is normal, AC is normal, we need to think AFI is normal, Doppler is normal. So this is not an FGR and we should not get too worried about it. So this is just to give you an example of how we need to actually interpret these findings in our day-to-day practice and include a centile chart. So if we are doing the scans ourselves, all our machines have centiles. So we start looking at centiles, or if we are already looking, let's put them into practice. Or if you're not doing your ultrasound yourself, your radiologist colleagues should tell you what is the centile of estimated fetal weight and abdominal circumference, and not just say weeks. We cannot have reporting in weeks. Every time we do an ultrasound, the dating cannot change. Dating is done by the first trimester scan. And if she is today, she is 30 weeks, the rest of the values are to be given in centiles. And dating cannot change every time. Now, she's another lady who's, say, 29-year-old, and she had a spontaneous conception. And she had an AC at fifth centile at an anomaly scan. So, right. So at least this is better than before, that it is mentioning that the AC is at fifth centile. So, but then you go and look back on the growth of the AC. If the AC is maintaining its curve, estimated fetal weight is maintaining its centile, then AFI is all right, Doppler is all right. So this again is a constitutionally small fetus, of which on serial growth monitoring is maintaining the centile, and AFI is Doppler is normal. Then in that situation, this is all right for a lady to be. So this is probably constitutionally small baby or a small for gestational age, and we don't have to worry too much about it. So I think these are very, very important distinction between, first of all, a normal and a small baby, and a small baby within a small baby, a differentiation between a constitutionally small baby and a growth restricted baby. So this was the point number two. Now coming to the point number three, which is we have to differentiate between early versus late. Now, this is very, very important to understand. Now, early onset has increased perinatal risk less, while the late onset has a decreased has a lesser risk. But it occurs quite often, so we need to understand this also. Now, early onset will have a more severe trajectory, rapid deterioration, and associated with other pathologies like preeclampsia. So we also need to identify the gestational cutoffs given the wider implications. Now, what is the difference in the etiopathology? Now, while early onset will have a decrease in the villus surface area, so, and the impaired trophoblastic invasion, which is very similar to what happens in preeclampsia. So there is increased resistance in the umbilical artery. This is the classical IUGR, FGR that we have been reading. So we know that it'll be first umbilical artery. Then from the arterial circulation, it will be brain sparing going to the MCA, and then from there, it will go to the ductus venosus. This is the classical early onset FGR that we understand, and we know that it has certain amount of morbidity and mortality. Now, what happens in late onset IUGR is not the actual surface area, it is impaired villus maturation that is the problem, and umbilical artery, because the surface area is not affected, there is variable maternal cardiovascular adaptation. So the umbilical artery impedance might not be affected. So actually the umbilical artery resistance might not be increased. So in that situation, what is an indicator is actually the MCA Doppler and the cerebroplacental ratio. So overall, the weight might not be, the weight is like, you know, is an indication, but the Doppler umbilical artery, which is actually the main sign in an early onset, might be normal, and which might lead to the confusion about the management. What is the cutoff before you say that whether it is early or late? So the confusion is between 32 or 34 weeks, but it has been seen that if you take 32 weeks as the cutoff, it has actually maximized the clinical difference in terms of perinatal mortality, perinatal adverse perinatal outcome, and its association with preeclampsia. So you take 32 weeks as the cutoff for early versus late preeclampsia. What are the individual problem? Now, early onset is the problem becomes the management, because you will diagnose, because the baby is so small that it is so obviously small that you will see that the baby is small and you know that this is FGR. Yes, you have diagnosed it. But what is the management? You cannot treat the baby. You have patients coming to us saying, "Bacche ko kuch de do." You give something to the baby, give fluid to the baby, give something to the baby. But as we all know, there is no treatment for FGR. The problem remains management. The placental disease is high. The hypoxia is high. The tolerance to, but the baby has a better tolerance to hypoxia. High mortality, because the baby might be 800 gram or 600 gram, while the high mortality is high. But the problem with late onset is you will not be able to detect it, because overall the baby has grown well till 32 to 34 weeks. So overall the baby might be looking to like a good weight baby. But what really happens is, and the, because the umbilical artery Doppler is not affected, the placental disease is not being reflected. Hypoxia is only reflected by the way of middle cerebral artery adaptations. And also, but the problem with the baby remains that its tolerance to hypoxia is low. So that is what results in baby adverse perinatal outcome in terms of stillbirths or hypoxia. The mortality is low, but the long-term outcome might be poor in terms of neurodevelopmental outcome. And it has been seen that the school performance of children who are born with late IUGR also has been poor. So that's the difference between early and the late onset IUGR. So coming to the definitions of these early and late onset, for early FGR, there has to be three solitary parameters. If the AC is less than third centile, or the estimated fetal weight is less than third centile, or there is an absent end diastolic flow, these are individually enough characteristics to say that this is early onset FGR. But if the AC is between third to 10th centile, right? Estimated fate is between third to 10th centile, there has to be an associated Doppler abnormality like a raised umbilical artery PI or a uterine artery PI to say that there is FGR. What about late onset FGR? If the estimated fetal weight again or the abdominal circumference is less than the third centile, along with it or at least two out of the three, that is AC is less than 10th and estimated fetal weight is less than 10th, or there is crossing of centiles by more than two quartiles. That means in the second trimester when we did a scan, the AC was on the 75th centile. And right now at your 34th week scan, the AC has now become say 20th centile. So although it is more than the 10th centile, the growth has fallen from 75th centile to the 20th centile. So it has fallen by more than 50 centiles. So this is actually falling. Although this is a bit of a soft sign, but it is also considered to be a sign of late onset FGR. And again, a change in CPR is important. So as we discussed, the main problem with early onset IUGR is mortality, while the main problem with like mortality and neurological morbidity. So if you see the mortality, the perinatal mortality of less than 26 weeks is more than 90%. So this is a very important figure to remember. While if you take it to more than 28 weeks, it is drastically to less than 10%. So it is even one day gain leads to an improvement of survival of more than 2%. So this is what is very important to consider when we are handling such patients, that even one day survival, one day continuation of pregnancy becomes very, very important. The neurological morbidity at less than 29 weeks is 90%, while at more than 32 weeks is less than 10%, and hence the role of Maxell for neuroprotection at less than 32 weeks, because it is high if it is less than 32 weeks, and more than 32 weeks, the morbidity becomes less. A quick look at etiology. Everybody knows that it could be IUGR, could be because of the woman, it could be because of the placenta, the mother, the fetus, and the placenta. Now, within the mother, if the mother is a known, has a hypertensive disorder, CKD, heart disease, or genetic causes like in the baby, like a congenital heart disease or aneuploidies, or there is a substance abuse, or in twins, or there's a teratogenic exposure, infections, placenta and cord abnormalities. Now, So these are the etiological factors. Now, essentially, if you have a patient who's coming in with FGR coming very early, right? So in that cases, you can, if the patient, so you can actually think about investigating that patient for the cause for IUGR. But if the patient has come very late at 34 weeks, so you will essentially depend on managing that IUGR, for which you would really want to know about the Doppler. So there is a limited role of investigating a patient for IUGR, and this is what we need to know. So if a patient, if a baby is structurally normal and you have ruled out aneuploidy, so early severe, early onset IUGR, you have to rule out aneuploidy, fetal infections, and essentially a fetal cause. Otherwise, we just have to manage IUGR, because not many cases you will actually find an etiological reason for IUGR other than a uteroplacental insufficiency. Now, what is the role of umbilical artery Doppler? I think this has been the mainstay of management of IUGR. And we all know that in a normal pregnancy, the end-diastolic flow will progressively increase. However, if there is fetal hypoxia, the flow will gradually. So this is a normal pregnancy in which the flow should progressively increase. If, however, there is fetal compromise with gradually increasing placental area, the flow will come down from normal to absent to a reversed flow. This is what happens to the umbilical artery flow in the classical pattern of early onset IUGR. This you will see. It might not be seen in a late onset IUGR. Now, umbilical artery Doppler, if you are monitoring, you, there has been a reduction in perinatal death, and the increased resistance is for diagnosis of IUGR, and reversed flow correlates with neonatal mortality, and it is crucial in the diagnosis of early onset IUGR. Now, what is the role of uterine artery in FGR? Now, uterine artery is a marker for defective remodeling. I know we have studied so much of uterine artery with preeclampsia, and there has always been an association with FGR. But the issue is that the Doppler notch has been found, uterine artery notching has been found up to 65% of normal pregnancy, and it can even persist beyond 20 weeks without IUGR. So it has a very low positive predictive value. And it has been seen that the second trimester uterine artery has a better predictive performance. And the sensitivity for identifying early onset FGR is only 40%. And stillbirth is even lower. So in that scenario, so what is the role of uterine artery Doppler if you think about it? So this is a waveform of a normal uterine artery where there is in the third trimester, there's increased diastolic flow, while in a compromised uterine artery, the diastolic flow will be quite less. Now, in the late FGR, it has been seen that it has the potential benefit of capturing placental insufficiency, which might be because of a defective trophoblastic invasion, or because of other mechanism, like, you know, when there is a defective maturation in late onset. So uterine artery Doppler again might be raised. And it has been seen that if the uterine artery Doppler is raised, then after 2 weeks, the MCA Doppler is normal. So there is some relation, some correlation, but yes, on a day-to-day basis, the changes in a uterine artery Doppler will not predict if you have to deliver today or tomorrow. So it has a role in diagnosis, but it does not have a role in monitoring. So we need to remember that about uterine artery. So if the uterine artery Doppler is raised, there is a problem with the placental circulation. It has a role in diagnosis, but maybe you cannot monitor it on a day-to-day basis to decide that, okay, I have to terminate it today. So that is a problem. Now, what is the role of middle cerebral artery? So middle cerebral artery, it suggests fetal hypoxia and central redistribution. Now, we know that it should be obtained near the proximal portion of the vessel, immediately near the circle of Willis. It may be abnormal for many weeks in early onset FGR. However, its role is more defined in late onset FGR, because in early onset FGR, we are actually trying to postpone the delivery of the baby by every single day. So we will wait till reversal of an umbilical artery flow. So in that situation, the middle cerebral artery Doppler really does not make much of a difference. But in a late onset IUGR, when the umbilical artery flow remains normal, we are actually seeing the middle cerebral artery, and it has been seen to correlate with increased cesarean section rates and adverse neurodevelopmental outcomes at 2 years of age. And it has been seen that with increasing affection, the diastolic flow in the cerebral artery will increase with increased affection. So early onset, as I mentioned, it is difficult to decide anything based on the middle cerebral artery. Now comes the most important marker in the late onset, which is the cerebroplacental ratio. So cerebro is the medial cerebral, placenta is your umbilical. So in this, basically, we take the ratio of the MCI PI versus the umbilical PI. And it is more useful in the late onset FGRs, and it is associated with a worse outcome at delivery as compared to the MCA Doppler alone. The CPR improves the sensitivity of umbilical artery and MCA alone because it is already decreased when the individual components are still within the normal range. So what really happens is, even if the umbilical artery is Doppler is normal or the middle cerebral artery is Doppler is normal, their ratio might be deranged, which is an indicator. And if the patient is already term, say 37 weeks, and you're suspecting that something is wrong, so a CPR is an indicator that there is an abnormal hemodynamic adjustment which is happening, so we might need to deliver this baby. Now, the role of ductus venosus Doppler is in early onset IUGR. When we are actually timing the delivery, each day is important. So it predates the abnormal biophysical profile by up to 3 days, and it is better for timing the delivery according to the late changes in DV. So there was a large series of trial, the TRUFL trial, where there's improvement in developmental outcome at 2 years of age if we are timing the delivery according to DV as compared to a computerized CTG. So we should, once there is an absent flow, we should monitor daily by a REDF for reversal of flow and a ductus venosus flow. Aortic isthmic Doppler still evolving, not much of a role in practical day-to-day management. Reversed flow in the aortic isthmus is a late step in the Doppler abnormalities and precedes the abnormal DV flow by a week, but it is not a suitable marker to predict early fetal death. CTG in FGR, it is a high false positive rate, but obviously it is when there is a absent flow or a reversal of flow, this remains a very, very important modality for a day-to-day monitoring. There is significantly reduced or prolonged variability or unprovoked deceleration. It is considered pre-terminal and it is not useful for early identification. But ability to predict fetal death is similar for short-term variability as late changes in DV. Now, computerized CTG, if it is available, it should be done, but the availability becomes an issue for most of the things. AFI, yes, it's a very useful marker. Oligohydramnios is associated with low Apgar score. There is no strong evidence related to reduced amniotic fluid to acidosis. But overall, we need to see the biophysical profile when we are actually monitoring these patients on a day-to-day basis. Role in early onset is not defined. As I mentioned before, is there any medical therapy for IUGR? So there is no proven benefit of oxygen, bed rest, or nitric oxide, or sildenafil. The Strider trial has proven to be not effective. So this was a Lancet review which says one step forward, one step backward. So it was not found to be effective. So there is currently no medical treatment for FGR. So with this, we come to the last part, which is the stage-based management of FGR. So all these babies, we divide into 4 stages. In the first, we have confirmed that the baby has FGR by an estimated fetal weight, which is less than third centile, along with Doppler abnormality. So that is first stage, in which there is mild placental resistance, which is CPR less than 5. So you have diagnosed FGR, and along with mild placental Doppler abnormalities, it becomes the stage 1 FGR. Now, in stage 2 FGR, you have ADF. Once there is absent flow, it becomes stage 2 FGR. When there is reversal of flow, it becomes stage 3 FGR. And when there is DV, A-wave reversal in the DV, it becomes stage 4. So most critical phase is to detect phase 2 and then probably try and deliver while we reach stage three. So it is stage 2 to 3 in early onset that we are trying to detect and try and deliver. So it is, if it is stage 1 FGR, so what is the protocol for management is the mode of delivery. Stage 1 is stage 1 criteria, we all know that it is estimated fetal weight less than third centile or a CPR more than 95th centile. So delivery is done at 37 weeks. So all stage 1 FGRs we are currently delivering at 37 weeks. Monitoring is weekly and the mode of delivery remains vaginal. In stage 2 FGR, we know that the umbilical artery is when it is reversed. Then the delivery is, we do not take the pregnancy beyond 34 weeks. Now, it can be a bit flexible according to the facility of your nursery and the biophysical profile and your daily monitoring. So, but yes, never take the, we do not take the pregnancy beyond 34 weeks. The follow-up is bi-weekly and the mode of delivery remains LSCS. Then in stage 3, when you have a reversal of end-diastolic flow, the delivery again, so this is the upper limit of delivery. It does not mean that you take every baby till 30 weeks, but yes, that's the upper limit. So if you have diagnosed it at 30 weeks, you deliver at 30 weeks. But if you have diagnosed it at 26 weeks, you see the estimated fetal weight, you see the availability of nursery, the capability of the nursery, and then you have to deliver accordingly. The follow-up has to be every day if it's a REDF, and the mode of delivery remains LSCS. And stage 4 is DV reversal. We really need to prognosticate and see for the estimated fetal weight, whether really we need to counsel that patient on how much of a chance they want to take with the baby. And then probably you deliver the baby as soon as you diagnose a DV reversal. So the first step is identify a small baby. Distinguish between SGA and FGR. If a small baby is associated with Doppler abnormalities, it is FGR. If not, it is a small for gestational age. You can go on till 40 weeks with a biweekly, once in 2 weeks monitoring. If it is FGR stage 1, that is only Doppler abnormalities, then you deliver at 37 weeks. If it is AEDF, do not go beyond 34 weeks. If it is REDF, do not go beyond 30 weeks. And if it is reversal in DV, then you deliver anytime you diagnose, if the baby has. So this was just one more case which had such a difficult stage 3 FGR. She was a 31-year-old known case of APLA with previous IUD and massive proteinuria with a chronic kidney disease, in which all this is expected to happen, that she had high blood pressure. And at 24 weeks, and she was already on antihypertensive and she had early onset FGR, and she had an estimated fetal weight of less than third centile. And then when she came, because her Dopplers were all right, so we kept on monitoring her and we continued monitoring her daily almost, and till 28 weeks, when her Doppler became showed a reverse end diastolic flow, but the DV still had forward flow, but we delivered her by a cesarean section at 28 weeks, and the baby boy was born with 618 grams, and fortunately the baby lived. Now, if we don't want to remember the stage-based management, there is this beautiful website where you have to go to the fetal growth and then go to the calculators, and there you enter the gestational age, you enter the LMP, and then you enter all the parameters that they are asking. What is the MCA Doppler? What is the umbilical artery Doppler, right? And what are the parameters? So then it will give you the stage of the IUGR and what is the recommendation to be followed, whether delivery or follow-up after 1 to 2 days. So again, just to conclude, this first, identify a small fetus, distinguish between SGA and FGR. If it is FGR, stage 1, 37, stage 2, not more than 34, stage 3, not more than 30, and stage 4, it is going to be anytime. So to conclude, timing of delivery is the most essential thing in FGR. Before 32 to 34 weeks, based delivery based on the ductus venosus, after 34 weeks, It is basically the umbilical artery Doppler. If umbilical artery Doppler is normal, but MCA at or below the fifth centile, the sign of cerebral redistribution, and again, think about CPR, the aortic isthmus has still to be defined. And when we are talking about early versus late FGR, we have to understand that the problem with early FGR is management, and the late onset FGR is diagnosis. Late onset FGR is the reason why we might be having a stillbirth or a IUD that we probably thought that everything else was normal. So late onset FGR need to be known and handled better, to be diagnosed and handled better. So I think that is all I want to say. And then if there are any questions, we have a few questions here. Let me start by answering a few of them. First of all, we have from Chandigarh, Kamla, we have from Chandigarh. She's asking, when should we start low-dose aspirin in previous IUGR? Well, I think this is a good question, because there is a role of low-dose aspirin in previous IUGR, but and various studies have said that because any placental pathology that we are doing, we might be having. So there is a role, but we need to start it between 12 to 16 weeks. After 16 weeks, there is no role of aspirin. And so that should be started, and a higher dose is preferable, between 80 to 150 milligram. Now, another question is that how early can IUGR be detected? Well, I would like to say that in case, so as soon as you start doing your growth scans, right? So an early IUGR can be detected. So it can be detected very early, as soon as even during your second trimester scan, when you're doing an anomaly scan also. Then also in that situation, we need to think about aneuploidies. A very early onset IUGR could be a marker for severe fetal infection or aneuploidy. So even at an 18 to 20 week scan. So even at an 11 to 14 week scan, you could detect a discrepancy, but obviously you would not act on it. But yes, and very early at an anomaly scan, if you are detecting a lot of asymmetry and you think that there is a lot of discrepancy in growth, then it could be a marker for early onset IUGR. Now, how are fetal growth restrictions diagnosed? I mean, I think it is based on the ultrasound parameters of the biparietal diameter, the abdominal circumference, and the femur length. What causes the fetus not to grow? I think this is a huge question that is very difficult to answer, because we also do not know the exact causes, but the causes can be divided into maternal, fetal, and placental causes, as we discussed. And the maternal causes are essentially if the mother has a kidney disease or a heart disease or anemia, severe anemia, or anything which is actually affecting the mother, any chronic illness in the mother can affect the baby. The fetal causes could be that the fetus has some, you know, aneuploidy or any structural malformation. That could be the other reason why fetus is not growing. Or there could be some placental cause. If there is some problem, some infection in the placenta or some other cause, that could be the reason why the fetus is not growing. But whatever the reason, the main thing is important is actually the monitoring of the fetus. That is remains very important. What are the probabilities? Now, the next question is that what are the probabilities of a growth restricted baby's catching up? Actually, that's not very high. If it is a, say, small for gestational age baby, they usually, so this is actually Pariniti from Bangalore. So, well, I would like to say that, you know, if it's a small for gestational age baby, then in that situation, that baby would maintain its centile. And otherwise, if it's a baby is growth restricted and there's continued uteroplacental insufficiency, then in that situation, the catching up situation really doesn't happen too much. So it's more important that it maintains whatever centile it is on and we have achieved some level of fetal viability. And there is Arshi from Mumbai. She wants to know which condition increase the risk of FGR. So I think we discussed this point and discussed the maternal, fetal, and placental reasons for increasing the risk of FGR. Okay, so Doppler, Sarita from Delhi. how can you explain this, the phenomena of this for diagnosis? So Sarita, I would like to say, like, Doppler, understanding Doppler is like a completely different topic altogether, but I think it's a detailed discussion. But what the basic principle is that Doppler velocimetry is trying to detect the flow in the fetal blood vessels. Now, fetal blood vessels are the umbilical vessels, which are the most easy to insonate. So if we are putting our probe on the maternal abdomen, then any vessel or movement which is occurring towards the probe is seen as red in color, and thing which is occurring away from the probe is seen as blue in color. So one vessel is the umbilical artery, the other vessel is the fetal brain, which is the middle cerebral artery, and the third is the maternal vessel, which is the uterine artery. So these are the vessels which we actually routinely use in the management of fetal growth restriction. There is Yash from Khandwa who wants to know if there is any role of L-arginine in the management. So as I mentioned, there is currently no evidence to say that any of the medical management actually works. So there have been a lot of studies, but nothing has really worked in an effective way. So we do get a lot of patients who have been in L-arginine and IV fluids and a lot of other management, but I'm sorry to say, but I mean, there is no evidence or hard evidence to say that these things actually work. Yeah, so I think we, as I discussed a few cases, we've already had some discussions, but yes, I think most importantly, the fact remains that the early onset IUGR becomes difficult in terms of management. And if you have a baby which is around 800 grammar or a 600 grammar, then the main problem comes from whether to actually offer termination, offer a cesarean section for these babies, or allow these babies to go for IUD. And then because these babies do have a prolonged stay in the nursery, right? So it kind of becomes very difficult. Like very recently, we had a patient who we had put in abdominal cerclage after 3 failed vaginal cerclages. And then she developed FGR also. So, I mean, such cases, and the baby weight was 750, 800 gram. And we had to deliver her, and we had to do a hysterectomy, of course. And so in that situation, and the baby eventually died. So it is sometimes difficult to do that. So it's a difficult decision, but counseling becomes more important. You have to explain the risk of nursery stay, prolonged nursery stay in an early onset IUGR, the risk of mortality, the risk of neurological morbidity, the risk of prolonged nursery stay. So, it also depends on the bad obstetric history. Sometimes the patients do want to take that chance because they've had lost a lot of other babies. We have a few more questions. There is a role of if NTNB is normal, double marker is low risk, and echogenic bowel on TIFA, now IGR from 30 weeks. Now, well, this is an interesting question from Vishakhapatnam, Dr. C. Chandana. Now, the thing is that when your NTNB, the problem with IUGR is that there is no standard agent for prediction of IUGR. Like for preeclampsia, now we are developing markers. But for FGR, there is no. Even if there is some things for prediction of early onset, there is nothing for prediction of late onset IUGR. But here, so if suppose in a double marker, there was low PAPA. That's one marker that actually says that there could be a chance of low onset for early onset IUGR. But again, it's for early onset IUGR. And here you're saying that there is a echogenic bowel on the anomaly scan. So again, echogenic bowel, as I said, so all of you must be doing a second trimester anomaly scan looking for soft markers. So we have to understand that when we are doing a scan for soft marker, echogenic bowel in itself is a very strong soft marker. And it's an indication for further testing. But you need to diagnose echogenic bowel as echogenic bowel. Not every bowel, which is, if you're sure that it was echogenic, that actually warrants testing, because the reason for echogenic bowel could be many. And that is the reason why the baby could now be having IUGR. So there is infection, the possibility of fetal infection. There could be possibility of cystic fibrosis. There could be possibility of aneuploidy. So echogenic bowel could be tested. So normally what we do is that if we are sure that it is an echogenic bowel, despite everything else being normal, we can test it. Now, prognosis, I mean, I can't really say based on one single thing, but yes, I mean, it needs to be followed up on what happened to the bowel echogenicity, if it was like a temporary thing, or it is still echogenic, or is there any bowel dilatation, what happened. So, and then obviously after 2 weeks, what is the growth trajectory? So there are a lot of variables that needs to be seen and followed up. So I think you should contact a fetal medicine person and, you know, keep that person in the loop to say for the prognosis. Now, what is the cerebral placental ratio in early FGR? I think that's a very, very important question from Mayuri from Gautam Budnagar. I think, as I mentioned, CPR is called late onset IUGR, but its role in early onset IUGR remains doubtful. Now, why? Because as I mentioned, in early onset IUGR, it's more of a placental pathology which is happening. There is loss of the trophoblastic tissue and the umbilical Doppler is becoming abnormal, and this is followed by a cerebral redistribution, and ultimately it is the umbilical Doppler which so if a patient is at 26 weeks and 28 weeks, I will wait till the umbilical artery becomes reversed to deliver her. I will not base my management on MCA or CPR. So I think that's the reason why I would say that CPR will not have much of a role in early FGR. So the management would really depend on the umbilical artery Doppler and not cerebral placental ratio. However, if it is a late onset FGR at 37 weeks, the CPR is deranged, I will like to maybe deliver that baby and not wait. Even if the umbilical artery is normal, but the CPR is deranged, I might like to deliver that baby. So I think that's the difference between early onset and a late onset IUGR. Now, Aditi wants to know if there is a role of arginine in previous IUGR. Well, there is no role of L-arginine in previous IUGR. There is a role of aspirin in previous IUGR, and we really need to know that how severe was that previous IUGR, whether it was associated with preeclampsia. In that case, we need to investigate that patient, but there is absolutely, currently there is no role of L-arginine in previous IUGR. Yeah, so I think I have discussed a few points, but I think the most important point that I would like to actually present is that, you know, most important is this chart that I think we should be having really, really imprinted in our minds, is that whenever you come across a small baby, whether it is clinically or by an ultrasound, we need to know whether it's a normally small baby or it's a growth restricted baby, right? So if it's a small baby with an abnormal Doppler, it's a growth restricted baby. Now, and if it's a small baby with no Doppler abnormalities, it's only a SGA, which is a constitutionally small baby. Now, if it's a constitutionally small baby, please do not deliver that baby at 37, 38 weeks. You can allow that baby to go into labor and wait till 40 weeks. If, however, the baby is small and abnormality, we will label that baby as growth restriction. And depending on the stage, we have lower growth restricted and stage one, only mild Doppler abnormality, we will have to induce them at 37 weeks because of that late onset IUGR and that fear of IUDs and late stillbirth. So we induce them at 37 weeks. So that's our clinical practice. So AEDF, REDF, yes, you have to deliver, you know, as soon as you think that the weight is good enough, and anytime, you know, not more than 34 weeks for AEDF and not more than 30 weeks for REDF. So I think this particular chart is something that we need to remember at all times. And the mode of delivery should be vaginal for stage one FGR, and for stage two and stage three, it has to be cesarean section. Stage four, we really need to think whether we need to do that cesarean because the outcomes are going to be very poor, and whether we really need to take that chance or let that baby go. So this is what I would like to conclude in the end. And I would like to thank Foxy once again, Dr. Alpesh Gandhi, once again, and thank you very much. And I hope you will find this session useful. Thank you.